Zoom is preparing to give the signal to YouTube for live streaming. Once they... Yes, I think it is going on. Let me get the green signal and after that, we will start right now. Is ready and our program is recording and also is in the live of YouTube in my channel. So if anyone is willing to share our program to their group, so they can copy it or they can share my YouTube channel to their channel also. Thank you. So good afternoon, everyone. Myself from Mrinalini Dutta Mahavidyapeeth welcome you all from this special international one-day special lecture on why you should be an anthropologist. Why you should be an anthropologist? This is very, very important and catchy title. I ever had gone through any sort of things, any sort of talk. So today we have our special guest. I welcome Dr. Tharakananda, lecturer of the Department of Anthropology, Faculty of Humanities and Social Science, University of Sri Jayawardenepura. And this university is located in Colombo, in Sri Lanka. So, welcome Dr. Tharakananda to our department on behalf of our college and also behalf of our IKC and our Teachers Council and all this, the apex body of our institute. I welcome you all and we are very fortunate that you agreed to deliver some of the important things regarding the anthropologies, and specifically it is important for our students. Those who have joined as a first semester and also those who are trying to establish themselves in the sphere of anthropology. So before inviting you to deliver your talk, it is my duty to introduce my department also. Okay. So and also welcome you by giving some of your introduction to the audience who are very eager to see you and learn from you. So our department is Department of Anthropology. It is under West Bengal State University. This is the one of the important college under West Bengal State University, Mrinalini Dutta Mahavidyapeeth. And this department established in 2001. And from 2004 onward, this department got his sanction as to run the honors course. And we have 3 years honors in anthropology. And we are trying to give some of the knowledge of the anthropology student in all dimensions, from biological anthropology, physical anthropology dimension, social cultural anthropology dimension, prehistoric archaeology and linguistic anthropology. Mm-hmm. Though the linguistic anthropology is not so much familiar among the Indian universities too. But some of the universities, their department also trying to establish the linguistic anthropology, and we are also very eager to learn the linguistic anthropology too. So in that particular department, we have near about 90 students, including the general and honor students right now. Mm-hmm. And we have 5 faculties. I am from the department, I am from physical anthropology background, though I am working in the domain of biocultural anthropology. So apart from that, Dr. Shrutish Mitha Senchoudhury, she's from social anthropology, social cultural anthropology background, and also Dr. Srimati Tonusri Polle, she's also from social anthropology and cultural anthropology background. And we are fortunate enough, we have another madam, Srimati Shashwati Rai from prehistoric archaeology background. And you are happy to know that we have another, our faculty, very promising faculty, recently joined, 1 year, just 1 year spent. here, Dr. Pushpalata Tigga. She's not only the faculty of anthropology, but the representation of the indigenous population of India too.
Mm-hmm.
So it is we are very fortunate, and it is our great platform in our department. We can share some of the important indigenous beliefs, knowledge, and all these things with her. And we share this knowledge to our student also.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the brief introduction of our department. And this year, we have 19 honor students and 13 general students. Apart from that, we have many, many students who are recently very eager to learn the scope of anthropology. And this is a very important platform where we can share it with Dr. Tharaka Ananda. Now, let me introduce Dr. Tharaka Ananda. Dr. Tharaka Ananda, she is the lecturer of the Department of Anthropology, Faculty of Humanities and Social Sciences, University of Jayawardenepura. It is located in Colombo, Sri Lanka. She got his PhD in 2019, and she did a great job, great research work among the indigenous population in Sri Lanka. So she was the topper in MA 2014, and also the founder of Sri Lankan Anthropology. This is a great job he did. And apart from that, she is also the founder member of our SAP. SAP means the Social Anthropology, South Asia Anthropology Forum. These SAP organizations, we have established this SAP, and Dr. Tharaka is one of the founder member of the SAP. And apart from that, why I requested Dr. Tharaka, because she has something different kind of understanding and different kind of knowledge. The anthropology as a whole, we are always telling that the anthropologists are trying to understand the society, the human being in a holistic way. So in Asia, there are few anthropologists who are trying to understand the whole things in a holistic way. So Dr. Tharaka Ananda, I think she is one of them. And in one hand, she did his very great job on the biological anthropology. And on the other hand, she has a very good understanding of the different theories and different kind of knowledge of social culture and anthropology too. So apart from that, she has published numerous papers in a short period of academic career. I think she has very, very bright and good future. And this is a great opportunity for us to learn from her on what are the main source of inspirations from anthropology. From Dr. Tharaka, and also it is a great platform to exchange the knowledge between the understanding of anthropology in Sri Lanka and India too. So from the bottom of my heart, and also on behalf of the department, Mrinalini Dr. Mahabidyapeeth, all of my colleagues, I again welcome Dr. Tharaka. Kindly deliver your priceless lecture for our students. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. Can you see my presentation?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Good afternoon, all of you. And in Sinhalese, Aayubhavan, which means you may live a happy, long life. Dear Dr. Apurva, Madam, Dr. Suman, sir, other academic members and dear students of the Mrinalini Dutta College. Let me begin this short lecture. And as you are new to this field of anthropology, maybe maybe you are very experienced in anthropology. However, considering the majority, I chose this topic of why you should be an anthropologist. In this picture, you can see and recognize the one of the prominent figures in the field of cultural anthropology, Bronislaw Malinowski. and who introduced the participant observation method to our anthropology field, and biological anthropologists who is among the skeletals, and archaeologists doing excavation. All these fields are related to anthropology, as you may already know now. And first, let us know what we are. Are we animals or we are differ? So first, what do you think? Do you think that we are animals or we are differ? Can anyone tell me? Can anyone let me know? What do you think about us? What do you think about ourselves? Are we animals or we differ? Can anyone tell me? Jishu Roy?
Ma'am, animals.
We are animals, yes. Yes, of course. We all ourselves human, and so there is a problem. If we are animal, but if we are also animal, what we are sharing with other animals? If we are animal, there should be some common things that we are sharing with other animals. What are the common characteristics that we have, and what are the differences that we have than that of these animals? These are the things that we have to consider when we are talking that we are animals or we are different than the animals. Yes, we belong to the animal kingdom, and we have a backbone that why we are belongs to the chordata phylum, and we are nourished with milk from special mammary glands that our mothers had. So we are belongs to the class of mammalia. And of course, we belong to the order primates, and we are evolving from the other primates. And now we have become a special species throughout our evolution. What we called to our species is Homo sapiens sapiens. So can anybody tell me how many species are there that human belongs to? How many species are there that humans are belongs to? How many species are there? Can anybody tell me? How many species are there? To how many species do we belong? Humans. Can anybody tell me, or I will tell? How many species?
If we anybody are, will, yes. Yes, yes.
There is only one. Okay,
yes,
only
Jishu,
one.
Jishu can tell.
Jishu, can you tell me how many species are there that we belong? How many species? Only one species, Homo sapiens sapiens. Whether we are African, whether we are Australian, whether we are European, we belong to only one species, which we called Homo sapiens sapiens. So only one species are there that we belong to. All over the world, people living all over the world, all over the planet Earth, belongs to the Homo sapiens sapiens species. And what are the features that we share with the animals? And what are the unique characteristics that we have as humans differing from the animals? I told you that we are also animals. Jishu also told that we are also coming from the animals. But there is some kind of unique characteristic that we have as humans. What are those? First, the name of Homo sapiens is meaning of the wise man, which means we have some kind of specific knowledge, intelligence when we are differing from animals. And what we have relatively, first thing that we have is a relatively large brain when compared to our body. When considering the brain size, always we must consider it is in relation to the body size. And our cortex of the cerebra is well developed, which is important for the learning. Cerebra is very developed and it is very important for the learning. And information, sharing, memorizing things, critical thinking, and for the intelligence, this part of brain is very important. So this part is very developed in our brain, which is very specific and very unique to the human being or the Homo sapiens sapiens. And the other things that we have is what? We can learn things. And what about the animals? Do they learn it? They are learning too, but they have the instincts that we get from their birth. But for the human being, it is different. We are not having instinct. We are learning things. We, from the very beginning of our lifetime, after we born, we learn things by looking at our parents, at the society, at the friends and relatives and other people. But the problem with the animals is animals are learning things by their instincts. Birds are making nests, and other animals who are having some kind of cultures is because of their instinct. Okay. And the other things, what make human being a unique species is what we can write and speak. And the most importantly, because of all the biological characteristics that we have, we could develop advanced cultural system which allow humans to live all over the earth. Not only one part of the earth, but all over the earth we are living because of the culture that we made as an adaptation to the environment that we live. And yes, animals too communicate, and some of the animals have cultures too, but not in the way humans have it. You may have heard some of the animals also have cultures and they communicate each other. They are having, of course, baboons, chimpanzees, ants, and bees have cultures, but it is not similar to our culture. We are advanced from that culture system. We are advanced from them in various ways. So due to the biological features that we obtained throughout our evolutionary period, we could develop an advanced culture, advanced technology, civilization. These are the things what make human being differ from the animals. There are various biological things, erect posture, we can walk upright and we can grab things because our hand is made to grab things. So there are different type of things what make us differ from the other animals. And next, how old are we? With these type of specific characteristics that humans have, what are the potentials, speciality that what we can do, not, what can do, but what should do? Think about it. What we can do with these type of special, unique characteristics that we have differing to other animals. And also, the other thing, how old are we? How old are we? How old our Homo sapiens is? We have only lived at about 300,000 years in this earth. At about 300,000 years as Homo sapiens. Our ancestors evolved at about 4 to 5 million years ago, but Homo sapiens, it means us. We have lived at about 200,000 years on this earth. So the next thing, when we are considering how old are we, there is something that we called a cosmic calendar. You may have heard about it. A cosmic calendar, it is a method to visualize the chronology of the universe, scaling its current age of 13.8 billion years to a single year. In this visualization, the Big Bang took place in the beginning of the 1st January, and the present day is considered as the 31st December. So in this way, if you can imagine when is our first relative, first ancestor begin, you may not believe that we have evolved in 31st January. 31st January, it means other animals like insects have lived from the 21st December of this calendar. So when it gets to the real numbers, they have lived at about 400 12 million years in the earth. 412 million, million years. Insects have lived on this earth. And what about us? We have lived only about 6 to 7 million years. All of those are our earlier ancestors. Only 200,000 years were lived by the Homo sapiens sapiens. So in during this 200,000 years, we have become the most important and advanced species on this earth. So there should be a very interesting things that we have done so far. There should be a very interesting thing that we have done so far to our earth and to our environment. As we have the largest brain, as we have the technology, as we have the advanced culture, we should have done a marvelous job to our earth. Is it true? What have we done so far as humans? This is what we have done so far as humans. You can see. So, what it is mean to be a human? What it is mean to be a human? We must live while letting others to live. So, this is regarding both environment and people and the animals. We have forgot that we are part of this environment. We have adapted to the environment by both biologically and culturally. So without coexisting with the environment and the other people, there is no future for the human being. So we made our culture as an adaptation to the environment that we lived from the very earlier time. The things that you have around you, your houses, the way you behave, the things that you use, tools, everything is an adaptation to the environment that you live. However, after becoming so much important and so much unique species, you have done a very bad thing as humans to this environment and to this earth. What about the other animals? Have they polluted the earth? Have they done very bad things to the earth? Do you think that we can live at about 100,000 years in our future? No, we will not be able to live at about 100,000 years in the future. We will only have at about 100 years like this situation. We will only have at about 100 years of history in the future. So think, what it is mean to be a human? And the other problem, I have to ask is there a special field that we can learn about ourselves and to understand ourselves? And finally, to do something for the entire human species and to the other animals and the environment as well. What do you think? Yes, there is. It's called anthropology. Anthropology word is coined by two words. One is from Greek, anthropos, which means the human being. And the other one is from Latin, which means logia, which means study, which is equal to the anthropology. And completely, it will become the scientific study of human being or the study of what makes us human, what makes us humans. When it goes back to the early 15th century, the beginning of anthropology. Anthropology is a subject emergent with the colonization that taken place during the early 15th century. People from the Europe, with the advancement of the technology, especially with the invention of sailing ships, started to explore the other continents of the world. As you can see in this map and the other pictures, you can see how different the people that lived in these kind of different continents: Australia, Africa, India, America, and Andaman Islands. How many different people, varieties of people lived in these areas? So when the explorers went from Europe to other countries, what they saw? They were surprised by looking at these kind of different people from the appearance as well as their culture. So what the explorers done was, they went Europe again and they told these stories to the educators in the Europe that lived in that time. So what happened? The educators that lived in this Europe during this type of period, they were surprised by the stories that told by these explorers, and they began to write the stories that they heard, which we call what? Armchair studies, the beginning of the armchair studies. Like E.B. Tyler, who lived in Europe, England, he started to write about the stories that he heard from these type of explorers. He wrote many things, and most probably you may have heard for your country as well. In our country, there are various type of documentaries that have collected and that have written during the colonial period. Most of these works told that there are some kind of people, not the people, but the animals live in Sri Lanka and Africa and Australia that have under-evolved, that are still evolving. They told that there are some kind of people who are similar to apes. Ape means, you know, the apes. So they have written their documents stating that there are people living in these kind of continents out of Europe. They are like apes. There are descriptions when I'm reading the literature for my PhD, which I done about the Vedda people of the Sri Lanka, indigenous people, I found they have wrote they are not evolved into the status of the Homo sapiens. They are like gorillas, gibbons, or they are some kind of species that has not evolved. So these are the things that European people thought of ourselves in the very beginning. It is true, but by the appearance and by the culture, all the other continents out of the Europe were very different. So this gave the beginning point to anthropology and sociology, archaeology, ethnology, and other social sciences subjects. As you may have heard, very beginning, physical anthropology was the first subject that began under the anthropology subject, because people were very curious about the different morphological patterns that people have. You can see in this picture, Red Indian have different type of nose, different type of mouth and eyes, and what it goes back to the African people. Their skin is very dark and they are having a very tall body, and they are having very thin bodies, and when it moves to the India, it is very different, and when it moves to the Russia and the China and the Japan, what happened to their eyes? They are very small and they are having very large bodies. These are the things that these people saw, and very first the physical anthropology was begin as subject in order to identify the differences between the people lived in these type of Australia, America, and other continents. So this is how it gives the rise to the anthropology. And as I told you about the armchair studies, let me explain it. You may have heard it. Armchair study is the thing that you are not going to the field, but you are listening to the stories that other people tell you, and you begin to write that stories and you publish it. It's like sitting on a chair, armchair study, sitting on a chair. You are not going to the field, but you are writing about that field without looking and without your personal experience, in hand experience. Empirically, you are not observing the people or the culture, but you are writing about them through the stories that other people are telling you. It is not considered as a best research method, because as anthropologist, as I told you before, Bronislaw Malinowski, who introduced the participant observation method, he told that if you are experiencing a field and a people, if you are living among a people, and if you are gathering the data on that people, it is the best way to write about a people, write about a culture, write about the cultural practices, write about the behaviors of the people. So we are no longer just in the armchair study, and I'm just told you how the anthropology begins. Now anthropology have developed as a very huge tree and with very various type of branches. As you can see, one of the specific characteristic of anthropology, so you can see in here branches of anthropology, especially the biological anthropology, and there are various branches: human evolution, human variation, forensic anthropology, paleontology, anatomy, and there are cultural anthropology as well. In cultural anthropology, there are various huge type of varieties of subfields that you can study. And then we have the linguistic. Under the linguistic, there are various type of subfields. And when it comes to the archaeology, there are other fields as well. And also, all together, these four fields have collectively one subject, which is called applied anthropology. It means in the biological anthropology, there is an application. You are studying the biological anthropology in the classroom, and then you are using that theoretical knowledge in a practical way in the field. You are teaching, you are learning the cultural anthropology in your classroom, and then you are going to the field with the application aspect of the cultural anthropology, which means the applied anthropology. And you are studying the archaeology in the classroom, and then you are going to use that conceptual knowledge in the class, in the field, which means the applications of archaeology. Salvation archaeology, you may have heard of them, and linguistic applications of linguistics. So if you have some kind of a specific and interested field, you can specialize in that area and become a specialized person in anthropologists in that field. So there are various type of things that you can study inside the anthropology subject. And the other thing is, one of the special characteristic that we can find inside the anthropology is its holistic approach. What's the holistic approach? Holistic approach is the complete study of human. Complete study of human. For an example, political science is a study only about the political behavior of the people, and the economic behavior of the people is studied. And in the medicine, what happened, or the biology, what happened, the biological aspect of the people is studied. What in anthropology do? What happened in the anthropology? In anthropology, we are studying about the human in a complete way. We are the one who know about the human's religion, economy, political behavior, and art, literature, and his biological appearance, morphology, what happened after the death, what happened if we can found a skeletal system after a human being disappeared, what kind happened. And this is how anthropology study about the human being. There is no anything that is not interested to anthropologists pertaining to human. Especially all the field are interested to anthropology. So that's what we call the holistic approach of anthropology. Holistic approach in anthropology. So in another example, I can tell you in geography, what happened in geography? Geographical behavior of the people and how the people are coexisting with the geographical location are studied. But in anthropology, what happened? All the characteristics of the people, behavior, culture, personality, socialization, mentality, thinking pattern, how he believe, belief system, religion, all the things are studied under the subject of anthropology, which means it gives you a complete understanding of the human being from the very beginning of the evolution to the present and about the future as well. We are thinking about the human's future in the inside the anthropology as well. So this means the holistic approach, which is very important as a subject that have, which is a unique characteristic of anthropology. And the other aspect that is very important is ethnocentrism. What is ethnocentrism? What is ethnocentrism? Anthropology is not like, now anthropology is not like earlier period. We are not accepting ethnocentric ideas. Ethnocentrism means evaluation or judging other cultures or belief of a people with our own standards. When we go to the research field to study other cultures, we must forget that we are first and that we are first and then to start our study. We have to forget what we are very first. If you are going to a field to study a culture or the indigenous people or any people, you have to first forget what you are. All the knowledge that you have so far, you have to forget before you are entering into the field. Otherwise, what will happen? Everything that you are collecting about that people is based on your own ideas, not the actual things that the people have. For an example, if I am going to study about the indigenous people in Sri Lanka, I have to forget everything that I know about the behaviors, about the education that I have, BA degree, the certificate courses I have done, and what I have about the behaviors of the people, and what I have about the food patterns, what I have about the belief system. I have to forget all the things in order to accept indigenous people's culture as my own. So I have to grab things from the indigenous people's culture as my own culture. This is what ethnocentrism means. We have to reject ideas of differentiation, ideas of thinking that our culture is the best. We have to reject that if we need to be an anthropologist. That's what important that we are studying anthropology. You have to think about it as well. And also next, with all this, how an anthropologist can make a difference? There's a myth in the society which says that anthropologists study only studies of traditional societies. It is not the truth. If there are humans, no matter about the time, whether it past or future, it interests anthropologists. Most of the anthropologists look on the future and hypothesize about the life on the moon and the Mars as well. So there are varieties of field that you can engage in and make a difference. You can engage in many fields pertaining to the anthropology and try to make a difference between the people. So you have to forget that people are saying anthropology is only about traditional society. It is not true. It is a fake. It is a myth. It has now become a myth. If there is humans in the Mars or the moon or the under the sea or in the future, it interests anthropologists. You have something to do in there. So it is not only about the traditional societies. It is about the present that we live. We have to find many solutions for the problems that our people are facing. It is not the job of sociologists, but an anthropologist as well. So the field of anthropologists now have become very vast. So we have to think about the people and what they have confronted. Do they have any problems? We have to give solution to them as well. In there, you can apply your theoretical knowledge in practical. I will show you how you can make a difference as anthropologists into your society. In safeguarding culture, you know, with the cultural change, with the globalization, all the traditional cultural practices are now diminishing. So you can use your conceptual and theoretical knowledge in safeguarding these cultural practices. In Sri Lanka, in India, you know, we are living in multi-ethnic and multi-religious society. So there are various type of cultures living in your country and ours. In our country, there are only 10 to 11 ethnic peoples are living. But in your country, there are hundreds of tribal people, hundreds of languages are there. So you have to work on safeguarding these cultural practices into the future. So this is one. And religion, for an example, you may have heard, religion is, in our country, in earlier period, there was a bomb blast. There was a bomb blast, Easter Sunday bomb blast. Our society was like this, before this bomb blast. And what happened? It shake our social organization. What happened? We are living in a society, and every time our social organization is going like this way, it is not happening. If there is not anything, the society is going in a line. But what if something happens? What will happen? This base is shivering. This is shaking. And then what happened? All the things that we are living on in the society, what happened? It breaks. So with the Easter bomb blast, our society was shaken, and we had to stay in our houses, forgetting all the things that we have done during that period of time. And also the corona virus as well. It shaked our society and it stopped our common lifestyle. So these are the things that we have to consider. We have to give solution as anthropologists. In religion, as you are living in a multi-ethnic and multi-religious society, and also as a religion is very sensitive topic, you have to give solution to the people when some kind of problems are occurring, when some kind of problems are there. And also political migration problems, traditional medicine, you have to keep that kind of knowledge. And pollution, water, environment, COVID-19, woman-related issues, right of passages, unidentified human remains. If you have a war, there may be unidentified human remains in some kind of particular area. For Sri Lanka, we had 30 years of war. So there are at about 5,000 families who have lost their family members and have not identified their remains as well. So you can work for them as well. Medicine and ethnic problems, children-related problems, problem of the elderly, nutritional problem, ethnic conflict, nuclear family problems. From the extended family system that now we have come to the nuclear family system. There are various problems associated with the nuclear family as well. And also social media related problems, human rights, abortion and religion, and child pregnancy and child marriages, indigenous and tribal people related things, population, human related problems. So there are various type of things commonly that you can see. Food related problems, issues, lack of spaces, population. And these are the things that you have to consider. You can work for these problems as anthropologists. I will show you how. Use of anthropological knowledge in the field. How you are going to use your anthropological knowledge in the field? You are some kind of people, human, that can make a difference to the society as anthropologists. The conceptual knowledge that you are gaining from the field, from your classroom, should use in the practically in the field. For an example, when I'm doing my PhD among the indigenous people of Sri Lanka, as I told you earlier, I saw that their culture is destructed. Their culture is destructed. Their culture is damaged. And I could saw there are various type of cultural characteristic that they have their own, which is some parties belong to the Sinhalese people, some parties belong to the Tamil people, and barely found indigenous characteristic of their culture. So I am studying about indigenous people, but I could not found indigenous, traditional indigenous characteristic of their culture. So I was thinking, why was that happened? So you can see in this picture, this is inside one of the indigenous people's house, and you can see there is a picture of Lord Buddha and picture of Ganesha deity, and also picture of some kind of Lord Buddha's statue. So traditionally, indigenous people are not offered to the Buddha or the Ganesha deity. They offered to their Nayakku. Nayakku means king demons. King demon means yakshas or demons that belongs to their relatives. After their relatives were died, they consider them as the relative demons. So they are the one who observed. So now they are observing Lord Buddha, Ganesha, and other deities as well. So I was thinking, what happened in here? And I thought that the most terrific impact that they had in their culture to destruction of culture was relocation them into a new village. They had traditionally, they lived in a village in the forest. Based on that forest, as an adaptation to this forest, they build their culture. And inside their culture, the religious belief system was very specific thing. Environment plus culture plus religion system was the basis of their whole cultural system. For an example, before going to hunting, they observed to the Nayakku and asking for the blessing. So there are various type of Nayakku or king demons that is lived inside the forest. But after they were relocating into the new villages, what happened? They could not ask blessing of that king demons anymore. Because of what? That king demons were living inside the forest, not in the new villages. So what happened was, in order to live in this new environment, in this new village, they had to develop a new cultural system. Imagine that without a culture, you cannot live in the society. You are talking, you are walking, you are wearing, you are thinking, you are behaving because of your culture you have. But without that culture, you are hopeless. What will you do? You do not know nothing. Imagine that you are kidnapped and you are going to, someone is putting you into China. How you are going to live in that new country without knowing that language, without knowing the customs? You will have a cultural shock. That is what happened to the indigenous people as well. So in order to live inside this new village or the new urban area, the indigenous people had to borrow new cultural practices from the Sinhalese people and from the Tamil people. That's what happened into their cultural system today. So there are no traditional cultural practices among them so far. There are some kind of mixture of Sinhalese and Tamils and Muslim cultural practices among the traditional indigenous people of Sri Lanka. So when they were relocating into these new villages, if there were anthropologists in that procedure, in that program, in that project, he could have told to the government, don't do this kind of thing to these people because their basis of culture is the environment that they lived. This could not happen. This would not have happened. So this is how you can use your anthropological knowledge to the field. And the other thing that you have to tell you is, you have to think as an anthropologist. Because you are the one who are having everything about the human being. You know their religion, you know their culture, you know their language, you know how their religion is sensitive to them. There are various types of religious practices. These religious practices are very sensitive to the people. There are people who are not eating some kind of foods as food taboos. So you are the one who know everything about the human, how they are behaving, how they are cooperating with environment, thinking patterns, political system, economy, everything. So as the one who are know everything but about the human, you are the one who should serve to the human with your knowledge of anthropology. In Sri Lanka, for an example, I'm teaching to this student of applied anthropology. So they are asking me how we are going to use our anthropological knowledge in the field. In Sri Lanka, after the student is graduated from the university, they are given some kind of government jobs, which we call development officer. In our one village, there are at about 5 government officers. So mostly our graduates become these officers. So I told my students, you don't want to think about that because you are the one who know very much about the people and their culture. So if you are appointed to a one village, first you have to gather data about the people that lived in this village, by age, by gender, by religion, by behavior, by education, by addictions, by occupation. For an example, rape cases and sexual violences are very much increased problem in Sri Lanka and India as well. So in a village, if you are appointed as this type of officer, what you can do? You can use your anthropological knowledge in there as well. How you are going to use your anthropological knowledge? First, you have to gather data on the people that are living in this village. Then you can identify their culture. What type of culture do they have? What type of behavior system do they have? What are the very sensitive cultural characteristics that these people have? And then you can see how many individuals are living in this village with a minor education, poor education, poverty, and without jobs and occupation. And then you can have an idea about the problems that may occur. And then if you have an idea about the drug addictions of these people, how many drug addictive people are living in this village, you can have an idea how these individuals are going to effect on the woman and the ladies and the female children of this village. So you have to have an idea first about the people and their behavior, and then you have to warn the other families, so you can do another things to protect these people. That's what you can do as an anthropologist. You are the one who know everything about the human being and their behavior, you can be a foreseeker or the futurist. You can see the future, what will happen. If there is these type of behavior patterns, what will happen in the future? You can imagine, you can predict the social problem that could occur. So I am telling my students not to stay inside home with the degree. You have to use your knowledge. If there is minor marriages in your village, if there is child abortions, if there is child marriages, child pregnancies, you have to start a study. You have to start a research on that. Why is this happening? And then you have to give the solution for that. So as anthropologists, this is what you can do. And what next? What you can be as an anthropology graduate? So this is something that you can target from this onward, okay? You may not have completed your degrees, but you can have some kind of target for your future. If you are interested in cultural anthropology, you can become environment archaeologist, ethnologist, ethnographer, linguistic anthropologist. Anthropologist specialized in films and specialized in political anthropology, art, literature, folklorists, and who are interested in indigenous people, human rights and economic anthropologists, digital anthropology, which is very important subject in today, and food and nutritional anthropologist, legal anthropologist, virtual anthropologist, psychological anthropologist, educational anthropologist, feminist anthropologist, and also anthropologist specialized in cultural change and archaeologist. And also, based on these all the things, you can become an applied anthropologist as well, based on the cultural anthropological knowledge. And then if you are interested in biological anthropology, you can be paleontologist, cognitive anthropologist, human evolutionist, ecological anthropologist, forensic anthropologist, bioarchaeologist, skeletal biologist, forensic facial reconstructor, and forensic odontologist, zoologist, anthropologist who are specialized in somatometry, anthropologist who are specialized in population genetics and specialized in osteology, medical anthropology, and ergonomy. If you are interested in the biological anthropological field, you can become whatever you need in these fields. So you don't have to worry about, and also there are application parts in that these things as well. And you don't want to be worried about being anyone after doing anthropology. So as I told you, a forensic facial reconstruction, reconstructor, you may not heard, but how do you think our ancestors were rebuilt? So based on the skeletal that we are excavating and having, we have to feel the skin and the muscles of the face, and then what happened? Then we can make the appearance of our ancestors. That's how the human facial reconstructions are going on. So this is one of the special fields that you can follow and you can become. So there are various fields as an anthropologist you can do. So why you should be an anthropologist? I think now the answer is with you. So the world is waiting for you, future anthropologist. The only thing that I want to tell you is read, and please improve your English knowledge and computer knowledge. You can be whatever you need after following anthropology. So this is what I needed to brief you during this 1 hour small lecture. I think you got something interested. And finally, I would say namaste to all of you. And a special thanks goes to Dr. Suman sir, who introduces me to this lecture, and to Dr. Apurba, madam, principal of your college. And finally, but for all of you, thank you very much. If you have any questions, you can ask me now.
Yes, thanks a lot, Dr. Tharakananda. First of all, we are extremely thankful to you. You are giving very, very brilliant lecture. And by incorporating all the dimension of anthropology, specifically our goal to understand anthropology in a holistic way. So I must congratulate all the participants who joined here, and also the viewers who are viewing your lecture in YouTube and Facebook channel. So now the time has come to put some questions and some knowledge. So may I request Dr. Tharaka kindly stop your sharing?
I think now fine.
Yeah. Yes. Now fine. Now the thing is that before going to the question answer session, so I would like to know you that our honorable principal sir, that he's madam, right? His name is Dr. Apurva Bandyopadhyay.
Madam. Sorry. I'm very sorry about
anyway. Some of the you know in the central part of India,
okay,
and the western part of India, Suman is the name of the female, right? So in many occasions, the organizers of the conference they put me into the ladies hostel for my accommodation.
Apurba is like Apurba is for Sinhalese. There is Sinhala name for Apurba as for ladies. I'm very sorry, extremely sorry about that.
No, that's fine. The meaning of the Apurba is, you know, that meaning of the Apurba is very beautiful. So our principal is beautiful. And no problem. So I really appreciate your lecture and your slides. Very good. Now some question answer session.
Yes.
Before going to the question answer session. So now I would like to ask one question put by the Shreya Mukherjee, that tribal communities are affected by COVID-19. So she is very interested about the thing is COVID-19 in the situation. In this situation, how anthropologists help them and what the important role of anthropologists in this situation?
Yes. I think she's not asking about the Sri Lankan situation, about the overall.
Yeah, I think so. I think so. Actually, let me talk some of the fact that in Sri Lanka, the indigenous populations mainly confined to the population as Veda. And Veda people have multiple groups. But India, we have officially recognized near about 705 indigenous group and so-called scheduled tribal group living in different parts of the India. Yes. So it comprises of the 8.6% of the total population of India.
8.6, so, okay.
And within these 705 groups, so more than 100 to 150 groups, they have distinct culture and distinct behavior.
Yes.
Still, they are practicing their traditional mode of way of living.
Mm-hmm.
So that is why they are asked that tribal communities affected by COVID-19, in that situation, how anthropologists can help. So ignore about the tribal population. Now, I think it is better to answer the relationship between the application of anthropological knowledge in order to understand the COVID-19 situation. Thank you.
Especially as anthropologists, we have to think about the behavior patterns of the people during this COVID-19. What would happen? We have to have the social distance, and we have to use new technologies using masks and sanitizers and other things. And we have to stop all the activities that we have done. So the problem in here is that human is a part of a group community. So he is living among a group like other animals. So we are not living isolatedly. So in this situation during the COVID-19, some of the people may have affected this very severely because they may have struck in one room, one boarding room or annex. So they cannot go outside this one house or the apartment that they were living or the annex or the boarding house or the hostel. So we have to think about the mentality patterns of these people, and of course especially we have to think about the resources of these people. We have to have some kind of connection between the people through the internet. Of course we cannot go to the field during these type of days. We have to communicate through the government, especially through the government, and to identify these type of people. For the indigenous people, too, this is common. And then we have to identify their mentality and their lack resources. What type of resources do they need? And through the government, we have to organize some kind of donating system. We have to give them the resources first. But first, the resources that they need, like food and medicine. And then we have to think about their mentality and their social patterns and the thinking pattern. And if it is a child, we have to think about his personality and about his other aspect as well. And then as anthropologists, we have to give some kind of assistance in overcoming these situations. So this is not a process that we can start during 1 hour or 1 day or 2 days. All the anthropologists have should share their knowledge and to find out one solution how to give assistance to these people. For in Sri Lanka, for an example, now I heard that one university student also get affected by the COVID-19. So now all are now trying to find what kind of relationships that student has with other students. So she is now taken to the hospital and now under treatment. Now we have to think about the mentality of the other students, because this is a examination period going on in our university. So we have to think about the mentality and other aspect of the people, especially in the psychological anthropology is very much important while treating to the people during these type of situations. So I think, do you need other things to, like, I can talk about this.
No. Yeah, exactly. You are said rightly that there's a huge connection between COVID-19 and anthropologists.
Yes. As
Dr. Tharakananda said that, and she's doing very good job regarding the COVID-19 cases also, is collecting the data during this pandemic situation too.
Yes.
So apart from that, today's discussion is basically based on the anthropology, why anthropology is important and for understanding in the holistic way. So Jishu put lot of questions there. Yes, I think that Jishu had huge interest regarding the different things. So before going to the Jishu's question, one question I think coming from Kanishka Vajardhana from Sri Lanka, I think.
Yes, he's from Sri Lanka. He's
writing that I need to ask about anthropological opportunities that can identify through India. Yes, yes, Dr. Kanishka, I will talk about these issues. But before the particular topic, because it is basically you are trying to get the answer from me through India.
Yes.
So I will give you the brief on that particular issues. But Jishu asked several questions, and within which I think, could you tell me which the biggest and or most powerful human species was in the past?
In the past, Homo erectus is the Homo erectus more than ourselves. Homo erectus lived more than like 600,000 on Earth, like that time. But we have only lived about 200,000 on Earth. We are going to like no longer. I think we cannot stay in here. But Homo erectus is the advanced more than us with the environment challenges that he received in the evolutionary history. He is the winner. Homo erectus. Yeah.
Now Jishu put another big question that how did changes in the Earth's climate affect our human ancestors?
Climate.
So Jishu, yeah. How did changes in the Earth's climate affect our human ancestors? Now, Jishu is the first semester student. Mm-hmm. So that's why it is in his mind that how the climates affect our human ancestors.
Okay.
Without knowing any sort of archaeological evidences or the changes of the climate in glacial and interglacial period and periglacial zone. So now he's asking about how did changes in the Earth's climate affect our human ancestors.
Okay, Jishu, your question is very interesting, and I have to tell you, we are here because of the climate changes. Without climate changes, human being will not be here. Because of the climate changes, all the African regions will become a desert, and the savanna lands appeared, and then our ancestors who lived on the trees had to come down from the trees and to walk to find out foods to a very distant area because of this climate change occurred in the history. And then we gained our erect posture because of climbing down from the trees. So it is another topic that we have to talk, and also our appearances after we migrated from out of Africa. We went to China, we went to Africa, we went to Australia, and we went to Russia, we went to America. The appearances we got because of the climate changes, because of the adaptation we made to the climate, and also some kind of animals who distributed all around the world because of what? Because of the climate changes. So it is the brief answer that I have to give to the Jishu, but it is another topic that we have to talk about, sir.
yes, thank you. Now, next question, Mrityunjay Pal from mm-hmm. our department, mm-hmm. he asks that, what is the difference between chimpanzee and gorilla?
Chimpanzee and gorilla is not very much different. Two species. It is two species. Chimpanzees belong to another species, and the gorilla belongs to another species. It is like, let me tell you, like common Aryan and a retriever in a dog's. You know, it is a two different kind of species that we have inside our primates. They are also primates, but belongs to the apes. Those gorillas and chimpanzees are we considering as apes, but two different type of species. Like we are having different type of species among dogs and birds, like that.
Yes. Thank you. So another question, LGX2301, I don't know he or she, where she or he is from, mm-hmm. but she raised the issues that you have told that social distance, yes, physical distance, why you are not saying physical distance? So do you have any comment?
Yes, it is because now you cannot physically distance somebody in your family. If you are inside your family, can you distance your parent from you and your husband from you and your siblings from you? But it is the physical distancing. But in COVID-19, the social distancing is the most important thing in order to prevent from having this disease. Because if your family is having the COVID-19, it is asked to have the distance, physical distance inside your family. But social distancing means your family should not be in touch with other society. So social distancing is the prime thing in the COVID-19, not the physical distancing. That's why. So as a society, we have to have our distance. I think that's why they are not using the physical distance word.
Okay, that's fine. Now, Shubhralil Mukherjee, he asks that what is anthropology trying to figure out about humans, and the answer found, what will they lead to where we are trying to connect?
What is anthropology trying to figure out about humans? In anthropology, we are trying to figure out about what we are, as I told you, what we are and what we should be. What we are meaning, what are the potentialities that we have? We have cultures and we have biological things unique to us. And with this culture and with this biological thing, what can we do for our future? Look around you and think what we have done so far. As I show you in that picture, we have made Earth a dying one. So as humans, looking at, we can have other animals as examples. They have not harmed, they have not done any harm to the environment. So what we have done as humans. So we have to learn from other animals and to go to the future while living and while letting living to the other animals and to the nature as well. So we have to lead to in anthropology we are like predicting there will be a one culture on the earth in the future. In the future there will be no cultural differences. because we are leading to the globalization and we know everything about the Indians and we know everything about the languages, we have common language now, the English. So we are becoming one culture in the future. So the in the global, in the earth, we will have a one culture in the future as the prediction of anthropologists. And some anthropologists are arguing that our physical appearances will be same in the future, like after hundreds of years, because our due to the these type of viruses and the global warming, what will happen? Every people will be have the same appearance as well, because we are now going to have, we are now increasing the climate. We are reaching the very hot climate thing. So we are having, we will have some kind of same morphology and same culture. So the thing that we have should have as anthropologists is the empathy and the emotions. Empathy, to have empathy, to accept others and to treat others as ourselves. So this is what anthropologists should do. And there are many things that anthropologists should do when the social organization is not working well, the anthropologist should be there in order to remake that social organization. So there are many things as anthropologists can do.
Thank you, Dr. Tharaka. Now I ask Dr. Suchishmita Sen Choudhury, my colleague and also my friend, for my department, Dr. Suchishmita, do you have any question? You can directly ask Dr. Tharaka.
Yes.
Yes, good afternoon. Thank you, Dr. Anand, for your excellent lecture.
Thank you.
I wanted to know two, I actually have two questions. First, you told about the scope of anthropology students in government sector. I wanted to know whether this is for the anthropology students only, or anyone who are doing any course in social sciences are getting opportunity to work in the village as development officer, and how they get such kind of opportunity. Does they have to sit for any exam or through interview, or what are the procedure? This is one question. And another question is how the NGOs are working in Colombo or in Sri Lanka, different parts of the villages, different parts of the country, and whether there is any scope for the anthropology students in NGOs, as we have in India, the anthropology students have lots of scope in working in different kind of NGOs. So I wanted to ask these two questions regarding your nation.
Okay, thank you very much. Answer for the first question, it is common for the all social sciences undergraduates. There are various type of occupations that they received after the graduation. Not all are not received, but through an interview, they are selected to these posts. Development officer, Grama Niladhari, and agricultural officer, and economic officer. Those are some kind of government opportunities, occupations that our students are receiving. Nearly at about 50,000 students were given these occupations. So to an interview, they have to face an interview. So especially when anthropology students and sociology students are facing these interviews, they easily get that occupation because they have the ability to research on the people and they have the knowledge about the people. So I think you got the answer. And answer for the second question that you ask about the NGO working in our country, there are various NGOs working on about our country. One is ICRC, International Committee for Red Cross, which is having a MOU with us as well. And our students, after passing out, they are, if they have, I told you, that's why I told you to the students to increase their English language as well. With their ability to work in English and work with the people, they are having opportunities in various type of NGOs in Sri Lanka, most probably to work with the indigenous people of the country and as development officers in some kind of projects like Mahavali development project, Galloya project, and other type of development project that is going on in Sri Lanka. And also to save the elderly people in our country, there are NGOs for that as well. And especially for the religious harmony, there are various type of NGOs. And also one NGO that is working on in our country is that is assisting to find out the missing people of our country. As I told you, there are various, at about 5,000 complaints are there in our country who have lost their family members during the war period. So there are that type of NGOs as well in going on. So especially our students who are specialized in skeletal biology and odontology, we have some kind of that subject under our department. So they have that opportunity to work with that NGOs in giving solution to that families. So there are various type of NGOs going on in our country as well. I think similar to India.
Thank you.
Now another question I crossed by Subronil, that if the culture will start disappearing, then why are people anthropologists busy in preserving culture at present? If at one point every culture will be unified.
If cultures will start disappearing, then why are people anthropologists busy in preserving cultures at present? If at one point.
No, you told that in future, if there is no culture, all culture, then. Then Subronil is there.
Okay.
Can you tell me?
Yes, of course. It is only a prediction. And with the things that are going on today, it could happen. But I can ask question back, because why we are studying history? If history is already happened, why we are studying history? Because based on history, we can know what would happen in the future. If we are having the knowledge of culture, we can go to the future.
Okay. I
have to tell you. Suman sir, do you know how to differentiate between a poisonous food and a fruit? You know. How do you know that?
Yes, based on the historical understanding.
Based on your culture. Your cultural knowledge that passed down to the generation to generation. Yes. How many forefathers have died through the poisonous food? Yes. Our forefathers may have died by eating the poisonous food, and then that knowledge passes down from the generation to generation. Whether there will be a culture, but that is come from the cultural system. How to behave, how to live, what is good, what is bad, all are coming from the cultural practices to the knowledge, to the generation to generation. That's why the study and preservation of culture is very important, whether there will be no culture in the future. But without a culture, we cannot live. In order to live like that culture also, in one particular culture also, we should have a knowledge. That's why the passing down of traditional knowledge is very important.
Yeah.
And
thank you. Yes. We are already past 1.5 hour. Now I know that the lecture the students are very much motivated, and regarding this after listening this lecture. So that's why they have their mind a different type of questions, and hopefully this is the start of the between the collaboration of Dr. Tharaka and our department, and hopefully in future we'll also invite Dr. Tharaka to join our course and join our different type of curriculum activities, so that our student also they can able to enrich themselves with the different dimensions. So before we end, I also now the time I have to put some of the clarifications regarding the queries from Kanishka. Yes, first of all, I welcome Kanishka. Thanks a lot for your joining this this international special lecture program, which has given by Dr. Tharaka Ananda from your country. And it is obvious that I need to ask. From anthropological opportunities that. Okay. So your colleague. Dr. Kanishka. Yeah, Dr. Kanishka. I saw his picture in internet also.
Okay.
In your website, just beside you. So it is very important, and that's why I invited Dr. Tharaka before 4 to 5 months regarding the involvement of Sri Lankan anthropological understanding into India. Yes, there is an opportunity to collaboratively work jointly the different research work in international platform, and so far as my knowledge is concerned, that Sri Lanka, only your university, Sri Jayawardenepura University, you have a very big department, and also the department of the different kind of anthropological knowledge. Now, if you go into the Colombo University, I think there is no such kind of department which also studying the biological anthropology, and as well as the cultural and social anthropology and prehistoric archaeology as a whole. So in India, we have the different kind of, we have near about 48 universities, like 48 central universities. And within that particular universities, most of the universities have its own anthropological department and full of faculties. Now there's a great opportunity for the every countries, including Indian scholar, Sri Lankan scholar, who can able to collaborate with the any sort of faculties throughout India, whatever your specialization is. So this is a very, very important background. Number two, there is some opportunities like Anthropological Survey of India. They have their international school in Mysore. They have their international school of Mysore, where you can also collaborate, and where you can also join for some crash course, for certificate course. Then obviously the director of the Anthropological Survey of India, Professor V.K. Srivastava, he was the professor of Delhi University. And if you'll search into the internet, that the topmost university are studying anthropology in Asia, there are 4 to 5 universities, like Peking University. Second is the Tokyo University. Third is the Chinese University of Hong Kong. And fourth is the Delhi University. These four universities are the topmost university where different kind of anthropological understandings are going on, irrespective of that fact that Chinese University of Hong Kong and Peking University, and these two universities and Tokyo University. These three universities specifically, they are understand anthropology on the social cultural aspects, not the biological aspects. So in the South Asian context, so far my knowledge goes, Sri Lanka, India, and Royal Thimphu College. Sri Lanka, India, and Royal Thimphu College, like your university, the majority of the University of India, and also Royal Thimphu College. These very narrow down department, they are doing all aspects of anthropology. So I don't know what's your specialization. Yes, opportunities are there. First is the research collaborations. Second is the fellowship opportunities. Different fellowship, international fellowship opportunities is there. And some of the time ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research, they also published Ministry of Family and Health. They have published DSR. They have published UGC. They have published some of the fellowship as fully scholarship program for the international students and as well as the faculties to come here and to do some of the work collaboratively. So apart from that, as I was the I was involved as a junior and senior research fellow of Indian Statistical Institute. So there is the department, that biological anthropology department, and also Indian Statistical Institute have his own institute as ISAC, International Statistical Education Center. So in that particular institute, they asked for getting the students from different South and African countries and also the Asian countries for the statistical courses. So through the ministry, you can also apply for that. So this is the opportunities. And now India is trying to establish some of the private universities where you can apply to join as a faculty or the part-time faculty or the guest faculty for your course. So yes, obviously that there is a platform where we can understand. And obviously, I think you learned that we have already established the SAF, South Asia Anthropology Forum. This is we built because for this urgency to amalgamate all the anthropologists from the different countries of South Asia, so that we can share our knowledge and we can disperse our knowledge throughout the across the countries, and we can build some collaborations in a solid way. So yes, obviously opportunities is there in India through Anthropological Survey of India, through ministry, through UGC, through MHRD. So there is some opportunities is there. Time to time the advertisement are coming in the internet, and obviously if that will come in coming time, then I'll share with Dr. Tharanka and also you. Please apply for that, and hopefully we'll get the fellowship, and please will come. Now think is that, what is the difference? So far as knowledge is goes that what Tharanka said, that is the assimilation of Vedas. So assimilation of Vedas culture is a very, very interesting thing. So assimilation of Vedas culture with the Hindu and also the Muslim culture. So this kind of story also exists in different parts of India. But the thing is that how this culture is figured out in the whole lifestyle of the people is very important for the anthropological understanding. So if we'll go into the northeastern part of India, so Christianity is a very major part. And so far my knowledge goes, the majority of the indigenous population in India, so-called scheduled tribal population, they are transformed into the Christianity. And still they are sustaining from the colonial era. Mm-hmm. Still they are sustaining the Christian way of living. And this Christianity build them to highly educated and also maintain the disciplined way of life. So apart from that, some of the communities in also like Chenchu tribal community, they're still practicing some of the hunting gathering mode of life in their own way in the border of Andhra Pradesh and Orissa and Chhattisgarh. So mm-hmm. I have some work among the Baiga tribal community in Achanabar Amarkantak Biosphere Reserve in the central India. Mm-hmm. So there's a huge opportunity is there. So Sri Lanka, as far as my knowledge goes, is very organized country, and they did great job for the stopping of COVID-19. I think obviously some human rights issues are going on, as Tharanka said me earlier, that some human rights issues, some of the people already been arrested due to the violation of the lockdown. So obviously the thing is there, but my knowledge goes that the people of Sri Lanka is very organized in nature. So in compared to Indian context, that's because the landmass is much more higher in India. The diversity is much more higher in India. The differentiation also higher in India. So for a particular bureaucratic understanding for a particular central government, it is very, very tough to control all the states in a single way, in a single platform. So yes, there is a difference between the South Asian context in different countries. But obviously, I am telling you, there is a uniqueness between the nations, across the nations in South Asia context, because they have the huge cultural heritage. And we have to understand very meticulously by joining hand together, in future, like this platform, not only a special lecture, but also this platform is one of the historical landmark where after so much time, where Indian and Sri Lankan anthropologists or student of anthropology, they join together and discuss some of the issues regarding the anthropology. So whatever I am telling in my class, whatever my colleague telling in the class, so Tharakananda, Dr. Tharakananda also telling similar fashion on a different examples. So that will all obviously, that is also motivated our students, and hopefully they will get the light of the scope of anthropology where they can devote their life, and obviously they will get the job. So apart from the Sri Lanka and India, anthropology is there in Maldives also, for a few colleges. In Bhutan, there is one college, Royal Thimphu College. They have their anthropology curriculum very meticulously. And Tribhuvan University in Nepal, they have their own department. And also Bangladesh, there is some universities, they have their own department, Department of Anthropology. And the Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, Vietnam, and China, Japan, all these countries, they have their own anthropology department, but they amalgamated anthropology with a specific subject like psychology, political science, sociology, philosophy. Now, anthropology have its own identification, and that is why I congratulate Dr. Tharakananda for this, the initiation for this movement to build some community who are speaking on the anthropology as a whole, rather than to so much specialized as American Anthropological Associations are trying to go into deeper. Yes, we are obviously going into deeper, but the thing is that we should consider the whole anthropological understanding in a single platform, try to understand the human beings in all dimensions. That is the huge motto and the motivation of anthropologists, and which can be followed by our student too. So this is the beginning. Thanks, Dr. Tharakananda. Thank Dr. Kanishka. So for joining this web special lecture and this YouTube live, all the viewers from the Facebook and also the Facebook and also the YouTube streaming. Thank you so much. And this is just the beginning, I think, for the collaborative lecture series. And hopefully you will also invite other faculties of your department, obviously through Tharakananda, as because Dr. Tharakananda have some motivation. So far my knowledge goes, and I request all of my students, please go through the website of Dr. Tharaka, personal website of Dr. Tharakananda. It is obviously very meticulously done and well-designed website. You will get very much information. Last things I would like to mention here, what the things are we should follow, that is the language, you know. So what the unique things in your department, you have the two portal. One is the portal for the native speaker and another portal for the English speaker. So those who are interested in studying anthropology in native language, you have the differently assigned and in your department, or so far as my knowledge goes, and another portal for the English who are interested to study the anthropology in English. So repeatedly we are facing this question sir, whether we are studying anthropology through Bengali language, or whereas we should study anthropology in English. What about your understanding, Tharaka? This is the last question.
As I told, they should follow English, because English is not a very difficult one. When the thing that you should have to do first is to start studying in English, and then automatically all the things will come next. So this is the thing that I am telling to my students as well, because we also have Sinhala students and English students in our department, but most probably they need English if they need to go to scholarship to other countries, As I told you, the world is open in front of you. To go to that world, you should have the language ability. So you should start from the English. That's the best thing. If you can start today, yes.
Dr. Tharakananda, you're absolutely right that I agreed your statement. And I repeatedly, I really motivated my student that at first you start English to talk.
Yes.
Whether it is wrong or right, it is different issues. But whenever you start, and the fear automatically weep out from your understanding, right?
Yes.
So that is why you are not all the native speaker in English, but what we can understand, that is that you have to have understand very basic understanding of English.
Yes.
So for your further studies. So what I would like to share with you, that there are some anthropologists who are studying brilliantly in Thailand, Malaysia, as well as Indonesia, Cambodia, Laos, and also Japan. But the problem is that they're not able to trying to express their understanding in English language. That is why they're not getting so much exposure into the outer world.
Yes.
So this is the another aspect. I would like to share all the viewers that, yes, nowadays the globalized world is open. And if you are trying to establish yourself as an anthropologist throughout the world, you have to have understand English, not very sophisticated English, but the English which is manageable to interact with the world people.
That is what we are also doing.
Yes,
we are not English experts.
Yes,
we are managing. Definitely. Yes.
Thank you very much, Dr.
Thank you very much, sir, for inviting
me. For today's speak, and we hope we'll join again in the later.
Of course.
Thank you.
Thank you, and bye, thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Bye.
Okay.